Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Hex Life, Wicked New Tales of Witchery, edited by Christopher Golden and Rachel Autumn Deering, narrated by Amy McFadden. An Invitation to a Burning by Kat Howard. Merinvale was a town that needed witches. Most places do. Witches, after all, are the ones who make sure the small and large magics work. Things like the rising of bread and the turning of the seasons and safe passage through birth and death. All the work of witches. Some places accept this, and so they welcome their witches the same as they welcome any others, and life moves in harmony. Merinvale was not one such place. Merinvale burned its witches when it found them. Most people, if asked, would swear that a witch burning hadn't happened in years, if it ever had at all, that it was only a story told to frighten people into proper behavior. But when the fog came in, evening thick, it smelled of burning wood and worse things besides. The Merinvale hills echoed with screams, and they called the fog the witch's breath. The fact that Merinvale did not want its witches, much less accept them, did nothing to change the need of the place for them. And there were, as there always are, those who made sure the necessary things were done. But magic, when ignored, when forbidden, twists upon itself and becomes strange. Witches, when forbidden, seek this strangeness and wrap themselves in its transformations.
"They burn witches, you know."
Ronald spat at the ground near where Sage sat. "So I've heard," she said, not looking up from the rabbit she was untangling from a poorly cast trap of knotted twine. Her hands did not shake as she did so, and her face didn't tense in fear, and Sage was proud of both things. Ronald was large, and Ronald was always angry, and Sage was not the first woman he had taken against. At least one of the others, Lila, quiet and lovely, had disappeared, never to be seen again.
"It's a good thing I'm not one, then."
"You could be," Ronald said. "And if you did burn, that's what everyone would think. Just another witch, gone and good riddance."
Sage lifted her hands from the ground and watched as the rabbit, now free, hopped away and out of sight. She curved her fingers into claws.
"And if I were a witch, and here you were alone with me, with no matches in sight, what do you think would happen then?"
Ronald spat again, his eyes pinched and mean, but he said nothing else, and he stepped back, away from the path where Sage walked. She kept her back straight and her head up, but the taste of fear, bile, and slime coated her mouth. Sage found the note on her front porch. Black letters on a thick white card, one she nearly didn't see, as a pile of maple leaves, rust-edged red, had heaped itself against her door overnight. But the corner of the paper showed through, and she set the information written on it to memory. It was an invitation to a burning. Sage arrived at the indicated address at precisely the correct time. She couldn't remember ever seeing the house before, which would not have been strange had she not lived in Merinvale her entire life. Even now, the place looked abandoned, the windows all dark. Her hand went to her pocket to remind herself that she had brought what was required. The door whispered open. Sage stepped inside. The cool violet air of the evening followed her into the house. Inside, the house no longer looked decrepit and empty. Soft candles lit floors of elegantly worn wood. The air smelled of the warm sweetness of beeswax and the sharp green of herbs. And something else underneath, something that flared her nostrils and raced her heart. Smoke. Nothing stopped her, and so Sage walked farther in. At the first branch of the hall, a woman draped in veils sat on a storm cloud gray velvet chair. She held her hands out, gloved palms up, and Sage set hers on top of them. The acrid scent of eucalyptus sliced through the warmth of the air, and Sage gasped, yanking her hands up and away. The woman in the chair did not speak or move. Sage squared her shoulders and set her hands upon the woman's again. The hands beneath hers were cold, the deep cold of iron in winter, and her joints ached from the contact. The ache passed into burning. The woman tightened her hands around Sage's and pulled her down, so close her veils whispered against Sage's skin.
Remember what it is the fire burns. Remember why you've come. Remember what it is to have power.
Her voice was familiar, not so much that Sage could put a name to it, but enough to know they had said their hellos in passing on the sidewalk or while picking groceries. It could have been a shock, but it was instead a comfort. Here was another, like her, quiet and unseen and powerful all the same. The other woman let go of Sage's hands and raised a gloved finger to her lips, silencing any questions. Sage waited a moment, but the woman was so still it was as if she stood next to a statue. Sage continued on. The house twisted and turned on itself, a labyrinth lined with bookshelves. Sage walked through narrow hallways, warm golden wood sighing under her feet, through rooms with furniture shrouded in dust cloths, past the sob of an unseen violin. The veiled woman's words beat along with her pulse.
Remember, remember, remember.
As she walked, she saw no one. She heard nothing. It was as if she were the only soul in the house. Then Sage turned a corner, and the hall opened up before her. Kept opening, really. It looked like a ballroom, where the back wall had been removed to let the night and the forest in. And she was no longer alone. In the ballroom were women Sage had seen her whole life, those she had waved to and passed by and traded bowls of soup and baskets of cookies with. Women who taught children and ran businesses and made art. They looked different than they did in their everyday lives, both wilder and more natural, somehow. Flowers bloomed in their hair, and vines twined their arms, a belt of bones chained a waist. As strange as they would have appeared on the streets of Marinvale, here they looked like they belonged. Shadows thickened like piled velvet in the room's corners. A spiraling pattern had been drawn in salt on the floor, incomplete sections open like the entrance to a labyrinth. Slowly, the other women in the room made their way toward the center. In singles and in groups, they barricaded themselves inside the boundary of the salt. They sat delicately, skirts pooling about them like puddles. They slumped to the ground as if they were wilting flowers. They tucked their legs to the side, leaned shoulder to shoulder, held hands. Connected. Sage felt something inside herself pull as they did, a thread that wound her into their pattern, and so she sat, too. Flames danced, salamander red, on the edges of her peripheral vision, and the smell of the fire grew stronger. But here, in this room, there was no terror in the scent, in the heat and crackle of the flames. The air snapped, electric, then settled again. The salt patterns complete, creating a barrier between the women gathered and the world without. The firelight flickered, shuddered, blinked, and when it settled, a woman with antlers spiking from her head stood in the center of the room. The antlers did not look like a hat. They looked like they had grown, curling up from her skull. She was shrouded all in tattered, tea-colored lace, from her antlers to her feet. Even her face was obscured. A shiver fluttered at the base of Sage's spine and traveled along the branches of her nerves. The hair on her arms stood up.
"You have come here," the antlered woman said, "to burn your past, to scorch from yourself that which you would leave in ashes, to cast off your old skins and make yourself new, to claim your power, if you are able. Bring what you would burn."
The same words that had been written on the card inviting her here. Sage reached into her pocket. She had hesitated while making it, this small doll that was a copy of herself. She had thought that it might be easier to burn a doll that looked like Ronald and watch all his hate rise up in smoke, or an image of Marinvale, to burn it before it could burn her. And so she took those impulses, the things she disliked in her own self, her fear and panic, and she sewed them into the doll that the fire would not destroy her, but would clarify her instead. Salt in the air surrounded the women in the circle like weeping, sticky on skin. The dear woman strode among them, regal. She stopped and brushed a hand over her head, bent to offer a word, a nod, to examine the offerings of those who had come to be witches. She paused before Sage, and the air smelled of the forest, secret and wild. In the woman's eyes behind her veils, Sage saw only reflected flames. The woman bent her head, an acknowledgement of Sage's offering, a blessing upon it. With each interaction, color crept up the hem of her dress, shadows soaking into the fabric, darkening it. Magic shimmered like heat in the air around her. Sage felt that magic too, felt it shake the air and quicken her blood. She felt part of herself reach toward it. The fire was brighter, the air sticky hot. The dear woman stood in their center, her dress red now, red darker than black, and wet, as if it bled.
"And now, the fire."
Not every woman there was a new witch. Some had already claimed their power and were there simply in support and community. The new among them brought their offerings to the fire, a private magic between the witch and her gift. Sage felt the flames like a warmth in her core as she tossed in her doll, felt them spark through her body. She felt an unraveling in herself, a calmness, as that which she had given up burned away. Margarita, who ran the bakery in the center of downtown, held her hands out to Sage.
"Welcome."
When they had finished, when the fire had chosen the new witches and they had accepted its gift, the antlered woman brought a bowl into the center of the circle, carrying it like a blessing. Thick and heavy-looking, a pattern carved into tarnished bronze, full of wine, darker than the night.
"Now," she said, "we drink."
What they drank didn't taste like wine, cold and deep, like iced plums, but also the bright sweetness of summer's first strawberries, the warm burn of whiskey in the lone hours of the night, the taste of flame. Sage's head spun. The room shifted. Sage could feel her heartbeat in time with the other women's, see the breath that moved in and out of their lungs. She could live their memories. Here, now, the fire that the fearful would use to take their lives, bringing them their power. The flames stretched into the night, casting their shadows onto the walls, bending and twisting them until the women looked snake-haired, until they were horned and winged. And then it faded, dying down, making their shadows recognizable again, until they looked like themselves, until they looked like witches. The dawn light replaced the fire's light, and the women, witches old and new, looked no different from other women that lived in Marinvale. The house shed its glamour to appear abandoned and forgotten, and ritual returned to ordinary.
"Remember, remember, remember,"
Sage's heart beat, and she did as she walked slowly home, the feeling of connection, of power, of belonging. And then the feeling of twine tightening around her feet and ankles, tangling her as if she were a rabbit.
"Witch,"
Ronald's voice, ugly with certainty. Light flared from a torch held in his hand, and the heat of flame crackled, and Sage stood in perfect stillness.
"And what if I am?"
"Witches are for burning."
The fire thrust closer. Sage reached inside herself. She remembered the feeling of her fear burning away, the connection with the other women, the witches, their welcome. She remembered her power.
"Are we?"
Fog rose from the ground. Witch's breath. The twine untied itself from where it had bound her and slithered away, snaking into the quiet darkness of the forest.
"Witch! Stop that!"
Ronald shoved his torch at her, the flames licking at her hems, at her hands, at her hair. None caught. But fog, choking thick, surrounded the edges of Ronald's clothing, his hands, his hair. The more he forced the fire on her, the thicker the fog grew, until the fire was gone and the fog seemed nearly a solid thing. Sage sighed out a breath. The fog rolled away, and Sage stood alone. Marinvale was a place that needed witches. Most places are, even if the people who live in them don't realize it. And even when hidden in secret, witches still hold power. Widow's Walk by Angela Slater. The house on Carter Lane, Second Empire style, mansard roof with dormers, a tower, patterned shingles, deep eaves, and elaborately pedimented windows, all painted in shades of white, cappuccino, and deepest chocolate, is home to four widows between the ages of 59 and 82. Once only Martha lived there, but the others gradually shifted into it as husbands shuffled off mortal coils, either naturally or otherwise. Some remodeling has been done, and now each has her own suite on the second floor. Large bedroom, bathroom, sitting room, and tiny study nook with a desk and chair. There's a guest room, too, just in case. Downstairs, there's a kitchen, library, and parlor, where the widows meet when they've a mind, for meals and discussions of various matters. Every morning, the first to rise, invariably Sarah, the oldest, whose bladder won't let her rest past 5, taps on the others' doors to make sure no one's died in the dark watches. Rumor in Mercy's Brook says that this task might well be performed by any of the three cats, only one of which is black, that have taken up residence with the old women. For, as all know, both felines and aged females are equally suspect. Although anyone who knows anything about cats also knows they are ultimately self-interested and won't trouble themselves to check on anyone's health unless it's likely to affect their own feeding. Despite the fact they're far from the coast, there's a widow's walk on the roof, which gives the house its unofficial name, but only Eugenie is inclined to use it. The youngest, she's surest on her feet, and she goes up there to smoke, sometimes blue-fumed she-roots, sometimes something sweeter to dull the pain of her arthritic fingers. Virginia prefers to sit inside the tower room and stare out the windows on the days when her inclinations lean that way, overlooking the garden, watching it grow, watching the foxes that visit. Sarah spends her time in the library mostly, reading and writing down the things she doesn't want lost to the world when she dies. Martha's favorite spot is the garden, actually being in it, digging and planting, growing and cultivating things for use in the kitchen and her apothecary experiments. They rub along, the widows, rather better than might be expected, given their differing personalities and interests, and Eugenie's tendency to swear mightily at the drop of a hat, which often offends Martha's delicate sensibilities. She's grown adept at pursing her mouth to communicate disapproval, which inevitably brings, "Don't you give me fucking lips of string, Martha Foster!" shouted so loudly it can be heard from the street. Yet they'll all admit quite freely that living with each other requires less effort than living with their husbands ever did, and when matters boil over, as they occasionally must, things simply settle back into a comfortable rhythm with no residual resentment or bitterness. They're all born and bred in Mercy's Brook, the widows, which isn't such a bad place, and no one actively points fingers and calls witch when they see the old women doing their groceries or taking tea at Abigail Hobbs' bookstore and cafe. Although those of German extraction occasionally whisper Hexen behind their cupped palms. No children throw stones at the pristine windows that Martha pays a local lad to clean fortnightly, nor do they run up to ring the bell and bolt away. Then again, that might have something to do with a fear that the black-painted gate might somehow lock itself at an inopportune moment. But Virginia has noticed with a certain glee that folks do sometimes cross the road when they walk past. Martha says it's so they can see the glory of the house better, not because they're afraid. Sarah and Eugenie don't bother to contradict her, though they roll their eyes something fierce. It's early, this morning, just gone 5:30, and the light is barely scraping the sky. The temperature is beginning to dip, and soon the leaves will be on the turn from green to orange flame, as if the trees are burning themselves to stay warm. All the widows are awake, 3 in the kitchen, 2 gathered around the coffee pot, 1 slicing the bread that's fresh out of the bread maker. No lights are on, though. Not today. Virginia's still upstairs, in the unlit tower room, which is empty but for the armchair she likes, a footstool, and a small polished wooden side table where she can rest her teacup in the afternoon. When she calls, they can hear her voice quite clearly, for it carries unnaturally well along the hallway and down the stairs. The place has always had good acoustics, Martha said before with a shrug.
Girls out there again!
Eugenie, Martha, and Sarah share a knowing glance and grin. Eugenie takes a sip of her coffee, then sets the mug on the counter. She opens the door to the root cellar, making sure to flick on the powerful lights that illuminate the subterranean room like a ship at sea. Oh, one of the others will turn it off as soon as she's in place. Then her slipper-clad feet take the path downward. Chelsea Margaret Bloom, mindful of the warnings she's heard about exits that snap shut at inopportune moments, has propped her bicycle in the gap between the gate and fence. It's still quite dark, and although she's done this very same thing 5 days in a row without consequence, she's not entirely confident. The streetlight outside the widow's walk never works, for the widows find it annoying, and no number of repairmen from the local power company have managed to fix it for any great length of time. Eventually, the neighbors gave up reporting it. The widows, strong believers in positive reinforcement, sent everyone in Carter Lane boxes of homemade cookies. Some were eaten and declared wondrous and almost as good as those served in Abigail Hobbs' cafe. In fact, they were identical, the widows being Abby's supplier. But others were sent straight to the bin, for some will always believe that no good gift comes from the hands of witches. So, Chelsea's at least reassured by the remaining darkness, by the fact she knows she only requires a few moments to do what she needs to do, and so is perhaps a little less attentive than she's been on previous occasions. She doesn't notice that the bushes of sneezeweed with their flowers of orange and yellow have been pruned back somewhat, that the tiny basement window level with the garden bed is ajar, or that a shadow moves behind its glass. It's still quite gloomy, after all, and she's paying more attention to the bigger windows for some gleam that will show her the widows are awake. There's nothing. Chelsea does what she's done the better part of the last week, takes a deep breath, and begins to tiptoe along the cobbled path in her worn sneakers, and tries not to think about how hungry she is, hopes that her stomach won't betray her by growling. Honestly, how loud could it be? She tries not to think about the tales they tell at school of boys who've set out to explore Widow's Walk and disappeared, only to be found a few days later, wandering in the woods, with no memory of where they've been. Although, no one can ever give her the name of those boys, and it's not as if Sheriff Taylor has ever been reported as looking for them. Or the stories of the girls who've gone to live in that house and come out changed, moving away from Mercy's Brook afterward, or staying. Chelsea shakes her head, eyes her prize. Two milk bottles on the top step, full cream with silver-blue caps on top. The milkman has already been, left the daily order. Chelsea only takes one, just one. She's not greedy. Heck, she'd only take half if she could, but it seems kind of rude to leave a half-empty bottle of milk. It's not like folk are going to drink the leftovers, right? Who knows what might have been done to it? Besides, it tides her over, that whole bottle, so she's only a little hungry by the end of the day. And when she gets home, well, generally, her mother has roused herself to get some groceries, make pancakes, or to bring something home from the cafe where she gets a few shifts a week, because Ms. Hobbs is kind. But lately, Ellie's been more distracted than usual. Chelsea creeps closer, hard to believe that this is the easiest house to steal from, but there you go. It's on her route to school, the neighbors aren't too near, and Chelsea's got an idea in her head that old folks sleep more than they actually do. She thinks, for a second, she hears something. A scrape, a creak, a crack, and she freezes. But though she freezes forever, or maybe only 15 seconds, nothing else stirs. She hears a crow caw and decides that must have been it, a fat crow on a branch too thin. Chelsea keeps going. She makes it to the top of the path, does what she always does, which is not to go up the stairs, lest she be too visible from the glass-paneled doors, but rather step to the side, half in, half out of the garden, the sneezeweed brushing her scrawny legs. She shuffles so her stance is solid, then leans forward, and her stick fingers are reaching for the nearest bottle. Slowly, slowly. When a hand grabs her ankle and she almost pees herself.
She certainly lets out a god-awful shriek that conjures a laugh, only a little malicious, from the cellar window, and activity at the front entrance, where two old women swarm down to her, embroidered dressing gowns flapping like cloaks, like wings. When it's sure she's in the crone's custody, the hand around her ankle lets go, the laughter gets softer as its owner moves away from the window, and Chelsea is bodily lifted up the stairs and into the house, astonished, in the beats between her fear, at how strong the widows are.
"She's too young for coffee, really,"
Martha fusses with more slices of toast.
"Well, hot chocolate will send her to sleep. Then how will the girl function at school?"
Eugenie seems to be mindful of keeping her language under control, given their company.
"You could give her tea,"
ventures Virginia. She's quelled by the looks of the other widows.
"I like coffee just fine," says Chelsea in a small voice. These are certainly the most peculiar witches, unless this is some sort of a gingerbread house situation and they're trying to fatten her up. She doesn't mind. The bread and jams are the best she's ever had. The first proper breakfast she's had in the longest time.
"Make it weak,"
says Martha, and when she turns her back, Eugenie pours the blackest of brews and lightens it only a little with milk. Chelsea takes it with a grin, not sure she should be so happy.
"So,"
says Sarah, who has long silver plates neatly intertwined with blue ribbons that match her eyes.
"Little thief?"
"Little thief," Virginia repeats with a smile. Her hair is iron gray, short and wavy, and her eyes an indeterminate mix of yellow and brown.
"You know, they used to accuse witches of stealing milk straight from the cows, leaving them with empty udders. Did you know?"
Chelsea is silent, but her gaze goes wide.
"Bottles are more convenient," says Eugenie lightly.
She's got more color left in her hair than the others, black, but with many rivers of white, coarser, thicker than the rest, like serpents with minds of their own. Martha, ash blonde, green-eyed, just butters more toast, adds lime marmalade without asking if the girl likes it. Chelsea, thievery notwithstanding, has good manners and eats it without complaint. Plus, she's starving. Martha says,
"Little thief, tell us your tale before we pass judgment."
Chelsea looks around, takes note of the three cats sitting on the sill of the kitchen window, all watching her attentively as if what she says next is of great importance. She's old enough to understand that her position is one of shame, not because of the theft so much as being a child whose parents cannot feed them adequately. The shame isn't hers, but she still feels it, suffers for it on her mother's behalf. She says lamely,
"I leave home too early for breakfast."
And the faces of the widows are all painted in various shades of disappointment at the lie. Not much surprise and a lot of understanding, but still, disappointment. Silence hangs for a long moment.
"Hungry thief, then."
Sarah's gentle expression doesn't waver.
"Well, you need to make restitution," says Eugenie sharply. "We need help around the house, especially Martha in that damned garden."
"I'd be happy of a scribe," chimes Virginia. "I'm cataloging the library."
"Sarah will be bottling jams and preserves soon enough," says Eugenie.
"What do you need me for?" ventures Chelsea.
"I've no need of help."
Eugenie looks the girl up and down, as if finding her of no use. It's not a mean glance, just frank.
"Then it's settled," Martha announces, and no one gainsays her. "Your penance will be to come here for breakfast before school every weekday, and after school there will be chores."
"For how long?"
asks Chelsea.
"Until your debt is worked off, or you're no longer hungry."
The girl nods slowly, then looks at them, in turn, as if reluctant to bring up a problem.
"My mother..."
"Never fear, my dear. We'll talk to your mother."
Virginia raises a finger to forestall any objections.
"But we'll not mention the small matter of dairy larceny."
"Thank you,"
Chelsea smiles with relief.
My mother worries. She gets stressed.
All the widows hide their lips of string, hearts warmed that the girl is kind enough to defend her parent, but hardened that the child must lie to keep herself protected from the truth. She looks apologetic now as she adds,
I do need to get to school. If I'm late...
Here.
Martha hands her a paper bag.
A sandwich and some fruit. Don't throw anything away, Chelsea Margaret Bloom.
Virginia sees her to the door. It's only when she gets down the stairs, retrieves her bike from the maw of the gate, that Chelsea realizes, between her capture and her breakfast, she hadn't ever given the widows her name.
The mother works at Abby Hobbs's place sometimes, Virginia says, as all four of them cluster at the largest window in the parlor, where the widows have been known to read fortunes for the townsfolk and whisper charms for the lovelorn, and watch Chelsea pedal off down the street toward Mercy's Brook High. Thin legs pump up and down, and flossy blonde hair flies behind her like something woven of spider webs. The heel of one sneaker is flapping, her jeans have been washed fragile, and her red t-shirt's faded beneath a coat that's nowhere near warm enough.
Pretty woman, terrible waitress,
adds Eugenie.
Always gets the order wrong.
Always?
Martha asks.
Always. It's a talent if you think about it,
Eugenie says with a shrug.
Consistency is rare.
That's surprisingly generous of you.
Sarah interrupts to cut off the inevitable bickering.
That girl needs new clothes for a start. The problem at home?
The boyfriend, says Virginia. The widows have been observing Chelsea Margaret Bloom for the better part of a week. Alerted by the cats, they'd watched her from the upper windows the first day she stole a bottle of milk, and every day thereafter. They took in her expression, her general demeanor, the fact she looked half-starved and all scared. They started making inquiries around Mercy's Brook. At Abby Hobbs, Eugenie and Sarah began a discussion about daughters with other women who were there. Everyone chimed in but Ellie Bloom, who showed a striking lack of interest in joining the conversation, which the widows noted. And they also noted, when Sarah introduced the topic of husbands, boyfriends, and lovers, that Ellie was only too anxious to chat about her beau, Teddy Landreneau. Teddy was a mechanic, employed at Hannigan's Garage, a man with long black hair, dark eyes, and pockmarked skin. He was not Mercy's born, nor was he pretty, but he was big, seemed like he might be protective, which was a mistake several women before Ellie Bloom had made. Others might continue to make it too, if she ever got her head right and gave him the boot. At the moment, however, that seemed unlikely. They'd been seeing each other for 4 months, living together for two, which was convenient, whispered Abby Hobbs, after he'd been thrown out of his apartment for fighting and not paying his rent. Sheriff Taylor had had to deliver warnings to him on more than one occasion. And these last 2 months, rumor had it, coincided with Chelsea Margaret Bloom looking thinner than she was genetically wont to be, and terrified to boot. The widows had seen plenty of girls with that same look, and they recognized it the first day she'd stolen their milk. Now, while Sarah butters more toast, Martha pours more coffee and asks,
Who should take Mr. Landreneau?
Me. I love a bully, says Eugenie.
Play to one's strengths.
I'll try talking to Ellie Bloom then, says Martha. Good luck, says Virginia with an uncharacteristic sneer.
Now, there's always hope, Sarah says gently, in one form or another.
You know where I'll be then,
Virginia finishes. She goes to one of the cupboards and pulls out a bright blue vial.
I'll have this ready soon.
School had never been enjoyable, but Chelsea kept her head down and didn't draw attention. She didn't yearn for friends or a greater connection. She did her homework assiduously, made sure her marks were good enough to keep her below anyone's worry radar. She loved reading and spent her lunch hours and free periods in the library. Chelsea tried to make herself as small as she could, so no one noticed her and she didn't attract her mother's random tempers.
She was doing well at it until Teddy entered Ellie's life, and, by unfortunate association, hers as well. Yet it had been manageable until he moved in with them. That crossing over, that incursion, caused a bleed in the rest of her life. She became actively miserable, and that drew notice to her as surely as a beacon. The mean girls, like tall, blonde Becky Silverman, suddenly found her a target for their barbs. Worse, the bully boys, whose eyes had passed over her unseeing for so long, suddenly saw her. Her schoolwork suffered, which meant teachers who'd had no concern for her now talked about her in the staff room as at risk. It didn't occur to Chelsea that her previous invisibility had been a kind of magic, something she could do without thinking, but also something that could, unfortunately, be easily sent awry by unhappiness because, unaware of it, she wasn't in conscious control of it. Since the shift in Chelsea's universe, since the veils around her parted, she's been in Becky Silverman's sights, which would have been bad enough on its own. But unfortunately, Becky's boyfriend has also noticed Chelsea. It wasn't like he was paying her court or anything nice, but Becky's kind of fucked up about relationships and can't tell the difference between what's healthy and what's not. So even though Evan's been making jokes at Chelsea's expense, it's enough to set Becky's jealousy off like a rocket. So, this afternoon, during English, which is the last class of the day, when Chelsea asks to go to the bathroom, Becky follows. Chelsea can hear the footsteps behind her in the hall, risks a glance over her shoulder, and clocks the look on the other girl's pretty face. It's enough to make her break into a run. She knows Becky's faster than her, too, because she's on the track and field team, but that's no reason not to try to escape. As Chelsea bangs through the big double doors into the fresh air, she trips on the flapping sole of her sneaker. She tumbles down the stairs, grazing elbows. The knees of her jeans tear away to leave the skin of her legs vulnerable to bruises and cuts. As she rolls to a stop, she finds a pair of old suede boots, red in color, very close to her nose. Chelsea cranes her neck to see a pair of black leggings, a burgundy tunic, and a thick-knitted long black cardigan. Yellow-brown eyes, iron-gray hair, and a kind smile look down at her.
"Trouble brewing?" Virginia asks, just as Becky Silverman skids out.
"Bitch!"
spits Becky from the top of the stairs. Her features twist, blonde curls do too, like snakes. Whatever has drawn this spite out of her, it's Medusa-like in nature. She begins to curse up a blue storm that might even put a blush in Eugenie's cheeks.
"Now, now, girl, if you can't say anything nice, don't say anything at all."
Virginia's right hand barely moves, but the fingers curl upward elegantly, and abruptly the stream of profanities coming from Becky's mouth ceases. Not by her will, though, for she keeps trying, and her eyes grow wider with every passing second that she fails to produce a sound. Virginia smiles, and the malign expression looks a little ill-fit on that gentle face. She reaches a hand down to Chelsea, who takes it with only a small hesitation.
"How long?"
asks the girl as she hurries down the path beside the old woman, whose pace is more leisurely.
"Long enough to teach her a lesson."
Virginia smiles again, and it's less frightening.
"Come along. We need to get you some new clothes."
"My mother..."
"Oh, darling. We both know your mother won't be looking for you."
Then, to soften the blow, she adds,
"Don't worry. Martha is making arrangements."
Eugenie spends her morning sitting in a cafe across from Hannigan's garage, making bad coffee and a stale pastry last. The roller doors are up, so she can see Harper Hannigan and his employees moving back and forth as they work. Eugenie makes a mental note to talk to Harper about his choice in workers. Suki DeLorme is fine, been with him for 13 years, but Teddy Landrino was clearly a mistake. He's muscular, for sure, and Eugenie lets her mind wander a little. But when lunchtime comes and Teddy heads off toward the low-rent diner a ways down the street he goes to every day, she's all business. She leaves money on the table, a generous tip, and a lot of crumbs, then follows Teddy with a stride not her own. It's a hobble, really, an old lady's gait. It distracts people. No one notices harmless little old ladies with limps. But before he reaches the diner, Teddy takes a detour, nips between the iron gates and the fence around the rambling park. Eugenie puts on a burst of speed now, no sign of the slowness of age or infirmity. She buries her hands in her coat pockets, the right one fidgeting with the items she finds there. The trees are thick around the entrance, so she hurries to get the mechanic in sight again, sees his broad back at last, disappearing around another bend. If she'd given it any thought, which she doesn't because she's concentrating on pursuit, she might realize he's gotten farther away than he should, even on his long legs, that he's run while out of sight, that he's drawing her deeper into the park, farther from the main thoroughfare, farther from the ears and eyes of witnesses, farther from potential aid. Eugenie's sturdy boots make no sound on the path, and that's probably what saves her. Teddy's not quite ready when she rounds the corner, so he's slow in swinging the thick branch, which in turn gives her a little time in which to jump backwards. He catches her a glancing blow, however, and she's knocked off balance. She totters, is amazed that he caught her, where her late unlamented husband Sidney always used to. The pain in her left breast is astonishing, and she remains incredulous that she never developed cancer there, after all the abuse. But it's over her heart, and she knows that's where all the true damage was done. Still in all, she's grateful. If Teddy had been prepared, he'd probably have taken her head off, or at least given it a damned good rattling. And, to her advantage, his misswing upset his equilibrium, and so gains her a few seconds. She pulls her hands out of her pockets.
Honestly, Eugenie, hands in pockets. How can you defend yourself that way?
The right one tugs the wooden thing up, and the thing makes a hollow pock, pock, pock as it hits the ground. Eugenie scrambles after it, but finds herself hauled back and held aloft. She's surprised, though she knows she shouldn't be, at his automatic, unprovoked violence against an old woman. What could possibly cause this? Being followed by an ostensibly harmless relict. Now she's being dangled. Her toes barely touch the dirt, the tips of her boots making a soft scrape. She feels like a cat held by its scruff.
Bitch!
Teddy sneers, and breath reeking of cigarettes and old meat hits Eugenie in the face.
What the fuck do you want?
She manages in her best cowardly quaver.
Why are you hurting me? I was just taking a walk.
Bullshit. You've been watching me all morning.
I was feeding the pigeons.
She injects, she hopes, just the right note of innocent despair. It's the truth, too. She always carries seed in her coat pockets in case she needs a cover. Prefers to feed the ravens, but pigeons are more numerous, less noteworthy, more mundane. He glares at her with eyes so dark that pupil and iris are indistinguishable. Whatever he sees in her face seems to convince him. Teddy throws her away. She lands awkwardly and feels the little finger of her right hand twist entirely the wrong way. Eugenie lets the cry out, even though her natural instinct is to bite down on it, but it will make her seem innocuous. She scoops up what looks like a twig covered in thorns and feels it puncturing her fingers. It doesn't matter. She's immune after all this time. Eugenie stands, shuffles over to Teddy Landerneau, who's now regarding her with utter disinterest. She moves past him as if to continue on her way. He doesn't even turn his head to watch her passage, so dismissive is he. And that's when she takes the opportunity to slash the twig down the back of his left hand. It's fast-acting, the poison, digitalis-based, some paralytic in there too, so he doesn't even have the moment required to make a fist. Then he's tilting and tipping as surely as a felled tree, landing with much the same shuddering effect on the earth. It'll look like a heart attack. The scratches look quite natural, something he'd incur in the fall. The widows are clever and careful. Eugenie stands tall, looks at her handiwork. The only effect the poison has on her is a slight numbing in her hand, which she welcomes, as it means she can't quite feel the pain in her fractured little finger. It'll do until she gets home and Martha can attend to the injury properly. Virginia has walked Chelsea home, neither saying much, and now they're at the mouth of the dank little street where the girl shares a dank little house with her mother. Virginia stops very firmly beneath the sign that reads Erebus Drive. She won't go further. She turns Chelsea to face her so she cannot see the police cruiser parked in the driveway of number 42, then hands over three shopping bags.
Make sure your mother knows these were a gift.
Chelsea nods.
Thank you, Miss Virginia. I don't...
Virginia holds up her hand.
Chelsea, your mother's going to be a bit upset. I'm given to understand that something's happened to Teddy.
Virginia pretends not to see the look of hope on the girl's face. She pulls a bright blue bottle from her pocket. It's stoppered with a small cork and sealed by red wax. It has no label.
How do you...
Hush. You'll learn that good and bad news travel at the same speed, but via different messengers.
Virginia drops the bottle into one of the shopping bags.
This will help her sleep tonight, and tomorrow she'll be a new woman. 5 drops, that's all. Then bring the bottle back to us when you're done.
Virginia touches the girl's cheek.
Remember that you are welcome with us any time. Should you need a refuge, our home is yours. The same goes for your mother. She is also welcome.
Thank you, Miss Virginia.
Chelsea smiles, then her face clouds over.
What about...
Oh, Becky will be back to normal tomorrow morning, and more's the pity. But you'll find her less willing to trouble you, I'll be bound.
And Chelsea?
The girl says nothing, just waits with bated breath.
We will teach you how to deal with ones such as her, how to walk in the shadows for your own safety. You need only attract attention when you wish.
And Chelsea thinks this is the most wonderful news she's ever heard, even better than Teddy's accident. She gives Virginia a swift, hard hug that drives the air out of the older woman's lungs, who laughs and hugs back. Chelsea turns down the street toward her home, which looks bleaker than it ever has. She stumbles a little, seeing the sheriff's car parked outside, then recovers, mindful of Virginia's comment about Teddy. She throws a glance over her shoulder, gives the widow a wave, and moves on to disappear up the broken path to number 42, Erebus Drive. Ellie Bloom's been crying for about 2 hours now. It didn't take long for Teddy Landerneau's body to be discovered by joggers, and it took even less time for Sheriff Taylor to call by and let Ellie know that he was gone from her life. The bruises on Ellie's cheeks and wrists made Sheriff Janie Taylor wonder if it was any loss at all, but that didn't seem to slow the tears. After a while, she then began to wonder where Chelsea was, because surely it was time for the girl to be home from school. Not that she wanted to leave Chelsea alone to deal with her mother, but she couldn't quite figure out what she could do to fix the situation. Janie had had men like Teddy Landerneau in her life when she was young. Her own mother had collected them like bad pennies. But when she lost her calm and said, "Come on, Ellie, you know you're better off without him, don't you?" Ellie just howled louder. Sheriff Taylor is therefore quite relieved to hear the jingle of keys in the front door and the sound of light footsteps along the short hallway. Janie hurries to meet her before she steps into the sitting room.
Chelsea!
Hello, Sheriff.
Chelsea, some bad news, I guess. Teddy...
But Chelsea just nods, and Janie realizes the girl already knows. The sheriff doesn't think to ask how. Mercy's Brook is small enough that news flies like a winged thing.
You give me a call if you need anything. I'll drop by tomorrow to check on you. Promise.
Okay. Thanks.
And Chelsea sees Janie out, takes a deep breath, then goes into the sitting room where her mother weeps on the love seat.
Teddy's gone,
Ellie manages through snot and tears.
I know, Mama. I heard...
And you don't even sound a bit sorry.
Ellie's tone is sharp as a knife, but Chelsea doesn't deny the accusation.
Mama, he wasn't good for you.
He looked after me, loved me, treated you like a daughter.
And that last comment takes Chelsea's breath away.
If Teddy's behavior was paternal, then no wonder the world is so fucked up.
Before she can form a response, Ellie starts in again.
And now you want to leave me? My own daughter? Ungrateful!
No, Mama. No! Why would you think that?
But Chelsea's voice trembles, knowing it's true.
That woman came here. That old bitch. Said they want to teach you. They'll take you. Take you away like they did those other girls. Taken from their own good mothers.
Chelsea thinks about the girls fostered by the widows, how they finished high school, then went on to college. Sometimes they come back to visit. When they do, Mercy's Brook stops to watch, all the gossips churning internally, whispering and sniping. Some stayed here, made lives, but all their mothers went off on travels when their daughters moved into Widow's Walk and have never returned from their holidays and have not been seen since, as she can recall. Ellie might not have felt quite so attached to her offspring had she not lost Teddy so recently, nor if Martha's visit this morning wasn't so fresh in her mind. All Ellie can think of is the older woman's voice, quite reasonable at first, as she proposed Chelsea, Ellie's one and only baby, spend some time being tutored by the widows. Then the old bat had finally lost her temper and said,
"You know, Ellie Bloom, you're meant to care more about what comes out of your cunt than what goes into it. I'm not quite sure if you'll ever learn that lesson, but I do hope you get the chance at some point."
Ellie couldn't know that half of Martha's high color was from praying Eugenie would never learn of her lapse in manners.
"I'll get you a drink, Mama, to calm your nerves. Then we can talk about all this."
In the tiny yellow kitchen, Chelsea finds a clean red wine glass and fills it to the brim with white wine from a box in the refrigerator. She's put the three shopping bags on the kitchen table, grateful that Ellie had been too distracted by her grief to ask where they'd come from. She digs the blue vial out of one of the bags, tips 5 drops in, resisting the urge to tip in more, an act of restraint of which the widows would approve, then stirs it in with her finger. She needn't have bothered. The fluid is clear as water. She hands it to her mother, curled on the love seat by the window, the crocheted blanket wound around her lap. Chelsea goes to sit on a chair opposite. She doesn't say anything, but watches as Ellie guzzles the liquid down with barely a pause.
"Now, Mama..."
"Oh, my, that is strong."
And as Chelsea watches, something strange happens. Ellie's outline begins to change, to soften. Her weeping changes into something new, something sharper and higher, a feline plaint. The wine glass falls to the carpet with a soft thud. Where Ellie Bloom once sat, there's a pretty tortoiseshell cat with long whiskers and a floofy tail, green eyes, and an expression of surprised displeasure. Chelsea finds a cat carrier in the garage, dusty, with a sprinkling of mice droppings across the top, from back when they'd had a pet. Chelsea packs her few treasures into the shopping bags. There isn't much she wants to keep. She locks the door behind her and leaves the house on Erebus Drive, makes the shortish walk to Carter Lane. Ellie meows loudly the whole way there. She's heavy, too, not just sitting in one spot, but prowling the bottom of the cage as much as she can. Chelsea pauses at the fence, staring up at the big house. The closed gate clicks open without her having to touch it, and there's only the smallest hesitation before she steps through. Tomorrow, Sheriff Taylor will drop over for morning tea, and the widows will let her know that Ellie Bloom's gone for a little holiday, that Chelsea will be staying with them for a while. Sheriff Taylor will look at the pretty new tortoiseshell cat sitting on the window ledge beside the black cat and give both a nod. Janie Taylor knows every inch of this house, having been fostered here herself. She will recall the widows telling her that the transformation only lasts as long as the mothers remain selfish. The black cat's never changed back into her own mother. She will wonder if Ellie Bloom will one day walk on 2 legs again. She will smile and pat Chelsea Margaret Bloom on the shoulder before she advises the girl to be careful with her shoes. The cats often register their disapproval in unpleasant ways, at least until they get used to their new living arrangements. Black Magic Mama. An Otherworld Story by Kelley Armstrong. St. Louis, 1995. As I throw open the refrigerator, I hit the button on my answering machine. A tentative male voice says,
Eve Levine.
As if I normally answer the phone by brusquely telling the caller to leave a message. The voice continues,
I was told this was your number.
A pause, then a throat clearing.
My name is Harold Palmer. You don't know me.
I catch the supercilious twist in those last words.
Of course you won't know me. We don't travel in the same circles, my dear girl. Not at all. I was told you are currently in possession of the Ariel Grimoire. That is, the lost pages of that spellbook. That sorcerer's spellbook.
He stresses the word sorcerer, unable to keep the indignation out of his voice. The thought of a mere witch possessing the lost pages of an infamous sorcerer's spellbook, truly an affront to all that is good and proper. I snort and crack open a Coke. As I slug it back, Palmer continues,
I don't believe you are aware of what you possess, Miss Levine.
Yep, totally am, but go ahead and explain it to me anyway. He complies, of course.
That is a rare and valuable book. And yes, I'm sure you understand that part. I have heard of your activities on the black market, but you cannot fully comprehend what you have in those pages.
Dark magic lost for generations, magic requiring human sacrifice with the promise of healing any illness or infirmity? Nope, I have no idea what that is.
It is dark magic, the darkest magic, in the wrong hands.
He inhales dramatically, voice hissing on the recording.
In the wrong hands, people will die, my dear child, die. Do you understand that? These are not spells for turning pigeons into puppies.
Palmer continues,
I understand that you are an independent young woman, raising your child without the support of a coven or a husband.
I choke on my Coke at that.
So I am prepared to offer you $500 to take those pages and dispose of them properly. It is vital that they be destroyed.
And you'll do it for me, paying me 1/10 what my client is offering? How can I resist? I say aloud, and then hit the end button as Palmer rattles off his contact information. On to the next message, where yet another sorcerer offers to take the pages off my hands. At least this one doesn't pretend he's going to destroy them for the good of the universe. He even offers me a substantial improvement on what my client is paying. I jot down his information as a potential future customer. I won't be taking him up on this offer, though. I may be a dark witch, but I'm not stupid. With the kinds of items and services I deal in, screwing over a client is a sure way to guarantee that the next time they need a sacrificial victim, I'll be first on their list. I finish my Coke, then I check my watch. Time for the most dangerous part of my day, braving rush hour traffic to pick up the kiddo at school. My daughter, Savannah, attends a private school across town. That's a luxury I can ill afford, but with my transient lifestyle, I need schools that'll take her for one term and not look too closely at her fake ID. As Palmer said, I am, indeed, raising my child alone. Have been, since she was born. Her daddy is a sorcerer, heir to one of the most powerful, and corrupt, cabals in the supernatural world. If I stop moving, he'll track us down. And what if he does find us? What will he do? Execute his former lover and half-witch child? Anyone who knows Christoph Nast would think that's exactly what I fear. Nothing would be further from the truth. I loved Chris. Still do. While I'm not sure he feels the same after 9 years, our daughter was indeed conceived in love. Chris is looking for me because he's an amazing dad. As a single dad to 2 great boys, he wants to play a role in his daughter's life. and it kills me to refuse him that. Yet his father, the Cabal CEO, would literally kill me if he discovered that a dark witch bore his heir's child. Even if Thomas Nast didn't murder Savannah too, he'd hide her where Chris would never find her. So I run for Savannah's sake, and for Kristoff's too. Better for him to know we're out here, safe and alive, than to be responsible for whatever his father might do to us. After creeping across the jam-packed city streets, I pull into the student pickup loop. Other parents are out of their cars, waving so their kids can find them. I stay where I am. There's no way Savannah can fail to see my 10-year-old cherry red Jeep in this snaking line of silver luxury vehicles. Do I watch these flawlessly coiffed moms wave manicured hands, reflect on Chris's wealth, and think, that could be me? Nope. I cannot even visualize it. I certainly wouldn't want it. But I do look at their daughters, climbing into those plush leather seats, about to be whisked off to horseback riding lessons and dance classes, and think, that could be Savannah? Yes, I do. I look at these carefree and privileged girls, knowing that's the life Chris would have given our daughter, and I wish that for her, all the opportunities and all the stability he could have provided, especially the stability. I can teach dark magic to suburban witches and earn enough money to send Savannah to private school. I can trade in black market artifacts and give her those horseback riding and dance lessons. Yet at any moment, I may have to say, baby, it's time to go. And she knows there's no point in crying about the friends she'll leave behind or begging to stay until her dance recital. My heart breaks for that, for the one thing I cannot give her. No matter how many damn grimoires I sell. I spot Savannah before she sees the Jeep. She's not yet 9, but already her dark head rises above the other girls, and most of the boys. She strides along the walkway, her waist-length hair swaying, with a girl on one side of her, a boy on the other, the three of them chattering.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.